Hello, and welcome to the TI Precision Lab discussing op-amp input and output limitations, Part 3. In this video, we'll discuss the details of output swing limitations, including the differences between bipolar and CMOS output stages, as well as the effects of output loading and temperature. Finally, we'll introduce the concept of short circuit output protection. Output swing limitations on op-amps are defined relative to the power supply voltages. This figure shows three common output swing scenarios. The first case illustrates an output which cannot swing very close to either power supply rail. In some instances, this output limitation can be more than a volt away from the supply. The second case shows an amplifier that can swing very close to both supply rails. This is called a rail-to-rail output, and the swing to the rail for this type of amplifier can range from a few millivolts to hundreds of millivolts, depending on the technology. The last case describes an amplifier that has good output swing near ground, but limited swing close to the positive supply rail. This topology is sometimes called a single supply amplifier because it works well for single supply configurations. First, let's discuss the classic bipolar output stage. The term classic bipolar might lead one to believe that this output stage is obsolete or only used on older devices. While it is true that it is common among many older devices, this output stage is still used in modern designs. The advantage of this emitter-follower output stage is that the AOL, or open-loop gain, of the amplifier is not significantly affected by loading like other topologies. Furthermore, this classic output stage has a resistive output impedance, the advantages of which are discussed more in the stability video series. The main disadvantage of this output stage is that the output swing is limited by the VBE and saturation voltages of the output transistors. This output limit can be a volt or more, depending on how the circuit is implemented. Looking closely at the specifications for the OPA827, an amplifier with a classic bipolar output stage, we see that the output swing is several volts away from each rail. Notice that the specifications for this device define the output swing for a specified load resistance of 1K ohm and an AOL of 120 dB and greater. The AOL test condition is included to show that the output can swing linearly within the range of 3 volts from the supply rails. It is very important to note that some output swing specifications may be what is known as a slam limit. A slam limit is the maximum output voltage the amplifier can provide, but the output is saturated and will show nonlinear behavior. If AOL is specified in the test condition for output swing, then the output swing is linear in the specified range. If AOL is not specified, then you should assume that a slam limit is given, which can be, again, saturated or nonlinear. In general, if a slam limit is given, you should add at least 100 millivolts of margin to avoid nonlinearity or output clipping. The two curves shown at the bottom of the page illustrate output swing versus load current and temperature. These curves are often nicknamed claw curves because they look a bit like an animal claw. These curves always show the slam or saturated output limit, so again, for linear operation, we recommend operating at least 100 millivolts away from the curves. Notice that at high output currents, the output swing drops dramatically. This is due to the short circuit protection of the amplifier, turning off the output stage to prevent damage. Notice that in this case, the short circuit protection at room temperature turns on at about 65 milliamps. This can be read from the claw curve or directly from the table. The short circuit protection is intended to prevent damage to the amplifier when a short or low impedance load is connected to the output. You should not expect to drive a linear output signal at this current level. Remember, stay inside the curve and give yourself enough margin to assure a linear output swing. To reiterate what we discussed in the last slide, the output swing in this table is linear because AOL is defined in the test conditions. The claw curve, on the other hand, is always a slam limit. For a plus or minus 5 volt supply, the table indicates a linear output range of plus or minus 2 volts. The table test condition also defines a 1K ohm load, which would correspond to a 2 milliamp current for the 2 volt output swing. The claw curve does not show the output swing at 2 milliamps, but you can extrapolate backwards and see that the claw curve limits are around 3 volts, whereas the linear range is 2 volts. Now we'll compare the claw curve for a bipolar amplifier to a CMOS amplifier. Notice that the CMOS curves have a much steeper slope than those of the bipolar device. This is because the output resistance of a CMOS stage is generally larger than that of a bipolar device for an equivalent collector or drain current. As these curves prove, the output swing of bipolar amplifiers are generally less affected by loading. With either type of amplifier, remember to give yourself enough distance away from the claw curve to ensure linear operation. In the previous example with the OPA-827, we showed that the output voltage range spec given in the table was for a linear output since the test condition defined an AOL greater than 120 dB. In general, when a high value of AOL is given in the test conditions of the output swing specification, you can be confident that the specification is implying linear operation. Let's now consider another device datasheet specs table. This table does not list a high AOL in the output range test conditions. Furthermore, the AOL specification later in the table gives a test condition of 500 millivolts away from the rail, while the output voltage range spec is only 220 to 350 millivolts away from the rail. This allows you to determine that the output voltage swing limit is actually a slam limit, and the linear output voltage range is actually 500 millivolts from each rail. Up to this point, we have discussed the classic bipolar output stage, which is usually limited to a volt or more away from the supply rail. As we've previously shown, the sources of the limitation are the VBE and VSAT of the output transistors. Notice that the classic stage uses a common emitter configuration. The rail-to-rail output stage, on the other hand, can swing very close to the supply rail. In the case of the bipolar rail-to-rail output stage, the output swing limitation comes from the VCE saturation voltage, which is about 0.2 volts for most transistors. The CMOS rail-to-rail output stage can swing much closer to the rail as the VSAT is lower, typically from 1 to 50 millivolts. The actual VSAT of the CMOS stage is dependent on output transistor sizing, so very low VSAT can be achieved with large output transistors. Of course, large transistors use more die area, cost more, and have larger parasitic capacitance, so there are trade-offs in sizing the output stage. Keep in mind that the output swing limitations for an op-amp can be considered rail-to-rail, even if the range is only within hundreds of millivolts from the rail. There is no op-amp that allows true swing all the way to the rail. Even the best rail-to-rail output stage will have some small millivolt-level limitation. Why isn't it possible to swing all the way to the rail on a CMOS rail-to-rail output stage? First, it's important to realize that there will always be some bias current flowing in the output stage, even if no load is connected. Normally, this is about one-half the quiescent current, IQ, of the amplifier. The second thing to consider is the MOSFET characteristic curve. Note that the lowest drain-to-source voltage, RVDS, is defined by the linear or ohmic region of the curve. For very low drain current, VDS can be very low, but it will never be zero. This minimum VDS is what sets the output swing limitation. In this example, if the drain current is 5 milliamps and VGS equals 4 volts, the minimum VDS is about 50 millivolts. Let's take a closer look at how loading affects output swing. Remember, the claw curve indicates a saturated output transistor condition. When a transistor is saturated, it acts as a resistance, so for zero load current, there is very little current flowing through the output transistor, and the saturation voltage is near zero. It's important to note, however, that there is still some bias current flowing through the transistor, so there will still be some small voltage across it. We will discuss this in detail later. For 8 milliamps of load current, the saturation voltage increases to 1 volt. You can calculate the resistance of the transistor to be 1 volt divided by 8 milliamps for a result of 125 ohms. For 13 milliamps of load current, you can see that the saturation voltage increases to 2 volts. Again, if you calculate the resistance, you get 154 ohms, which is close to the previous calculation. Note that the slight change in resistance is because short circuit protection is starting to turn on. When using an amplifier with a rail-to-rail output stage, it's important to realize that loading the output can shift the DC AOL. The example AOL curve on the right shows what could happen when connecting different loads to the op-amp. In this example, connecting a 10K load reduces the DC AOL from 100 to 80 dB, and connecting a 1K load drops AOL an additional 20 dB down to 60 dB. Some amplifier topologies are more sensitive to this effect than others, and in general, CMOS amplifiers are more sensitive to this effect than bipolar because of their output impedance interacting with the load. Since TI models properly model output impedance, this effect can be quantified during simulation. The output stage on all op-amps has a short circuit current limit, which is used to protect the output from damage in case the amplifier's output is inadvertently connected directly to ground through a low impedance. This slide shows a simple implementation of a short circuit protection circuit. The circuit operates by sensing the output current through resistor R1. When the voltage across R1 becomes large enough, it turns on transistor Q2. Q2 is intended to steal the base current from Q1 so that the output current of Q1 becomes limited. In this example, the current limit circuit sizes R1 to 10 ohms so that Q2 turns on once the load current reaches 60 milliamps. On the clock curve, you can see that the output voltage drops rapidly when the device enters current limit at around 60 milliamps. This output current limit will protect the amplifier if the output is connected to any voltage between plus Vs and minus Vs. So, for example, if the power supplies were set to plus or minus 15 volts, the output could be shorted to any voltage between plus or minus 15 volts, and the device would not be damaged. However, if the output was connected to a voltage outside the supply range, the protection circuitry would fail and damage could occur. This topic, including the external circuits used to protect amplifiers from overvoltages, is covered in the video series on electrical overstress, EOS. The short circuit output current limit is given in the datasheet table and can also be inferred from the claw curve. In this example, you can see that the datasheet table lists minus 18 milliamps for the sinking limit and plus 16 milliamps for the sourcing limit. This roughly correlates to the point on the claw curve at 25 degrees C, where it bends sharply due to the current limit circuitry turning on. It is important to note, however, that the current limit changes over temperature. You can see in this example that the current limit turns on at a much lower current level at high temperature. Also keep in mind that the short circuit limit given in the table is a typical value. The actual current limit will vary from device to device and will be affected by semiconductor process variations. For a robust design, you should not design circuits with output currents near the output current limit. A good rule of thumb is that at room temperature, the typical short circuit current limit may shift by up to plus or minus 20%. In summary, this video discussed the details of amplifier output swing limitations, including the differences between bipolar and CMOS output stages, the effects of output loading and temperature, and the concept of short circuit output current protection. Thank you for watching. Please try the quiz to check your understanding of this video's content.